Ladies and gentlemen, good morning and welcome. I'm Steve Johnson, Director of the Americas Program at CSIS, and if invite our distinguished panelists to take their seats and everybody else, and we'll get started with our program this morning. It's really great to see so many people here today. And before we get started, I just want to remind everyone to turn off their cell phone ringers to the silent or vibrate mode. And to remember that when we come to the question and answer portion of our program, to please raise your hand so that we can get a microphone over to you. And when that happens, please state your name and affiliation and keep your questions reasonably short so that we can entertain as many as possible. That said, why have we come here to have a panel discussion on Panama? Panama has a canal. It's a close neighbor and friend. Many Americans are choosing to retire there. Case closed. Not long ago, my colleague Michael Shifter at the Inter-American Dialogue remarked that it is a shame that we don't know more about Panama, and perhaps it would be a good idea to hold a panel discussion to fill in some of the blanks. So I discussed this with Jaime Aleman, Panama's former envoy to Washington and co-chair of the CSIS Ambassadors Council. He suggested a program on politics, security, press freedoms, the business climate, and economy that features the distinguished speakers that you see here before you today. Now, not everyone on this platform will agree with one another, but that is precisely the point. This discussion isn't meant to be a one-sided critique, nor a glowing report. It is meant to give you a picture of a complex society with problems similar to our own, challenges, as well as great opportunities ahead. Thanks to Panama's current ambassador, Mauricio Jaramillo, and his embassy staff, we have made some of the arrangements that brought this panel together today. So thank you, Ambassador Jaramillo. I think you're back here in the audience, so we want to thank you for helping us out with this. And thanks also to Vice President Juan Carlos Varela, Economy Minister Frank de Lima, and our other distinguished panelists who have taken time from their busy schedules to be with us today. It's not easy to get so many people and so many distinguished people that have high-profile jobs in a country to be in one place at one time. So to get us started, I'd like to call former Ambassador Jaime Aleman, a distinguished lawyer and public servant in his own right, to the podium to introduce our topic and our speakers, Ambassador Aleman.
Good morning. I would like to thank all of you for coming today. I had not expected to give an introduction, but Steve asked me to do so last night, so I stayed up and wrote a few brief words, which I hope will be helpful to setting up the tone for the issues that will be discussed today. We have a great turnout, which I believe is partially due to the fact that there has not been an event of this nature about Panama in Washington for many years. It was a wonderful idea for the Inter-American Dialogue and CSIS to join forces to hold the event, which in turn is a tribute to the great vision and leadership of both Michael Shifter and Steve Johnson. As you all know, Panama and the U.S. have had a traditionally strong and positive relationship. Unfortunately, that is still the case today. This bond has been further strengthened as a result of the recent ratification of the Free Trade Agreement by the U.S. Congress. The main axis of the relationship at the present time is the fight against drug trafficking and money laundering, as is the case with the Central American and countries and Mexico in their relationship with the United States. This is an area in which the Martinelli government, in my opinion, has done a very good job. The border with Colombia has been secured, while at the same time, several naval bases have been set up on both the Atlantic and Pacific coasts of Panama, which have greatly reduced the flow of drugs moving north through our country on their way to the United States, as has been widely reported recently in the press. This is, without a doubt, a very positive development, as is the fact that money laundering measures have been adopted that have made it much harder for criminals to use the banking sector in Panama for their illicit activities. Panama has fortunately experienced strong economic growth since the US invasion in 1989, and this has helped pull thousands of Panamanians out of poverty and into the middle class. Minister of Finance Frank de Lima will address this issue during his lecture, as will former Minister of Finance Guillermo Chapman, who will highlight some of the risks that lie ahead. Another very positive development that needs to be mentioned is that the Panama Canal expansion project, which will double the waterways capacity, is moving forward and is expected to be completed by December of 2014, which will in turn substantially increase the income that the country receives from the canal's operation. In addition, the government has undertaken several major infrastructure projects, including the construction of the metro, the expansion of the international airport, the building of a new convention center which will further strengthen our tourist industry, and the construction of new highways, schools, and hospitals throughout the country, which will further strengthen Panama's competitiveness and improve the quality of life for all its citizens. However, Panama faces several challenges, including the fact that the education system continues to be deficient, that income distribution is inequitable, and that the rule of law and separation of powers are sorely lacking. The threat to freedom of the press is also a major concern. Mr. Guillermo Adames, one of Panama's leading journalists, will talk about this in his lecture. Another area of concern is the perception that the government may try to subvert the electoral process in order to benefit its candidates in the next presidential and legislative elections, which are scheduled to be held in May of 2014. I believe that both Vice President Varela and the chairman of the Electoral Tribunal, Gerardo Solís, will address this issue in their respective presentations. Furthermore, corruption is widely perceived to be rampant and out of control, and is a potential problem for any company that wants to invest in Panama. There are almost daily reports about this in the Panamanian press, even though many people are afraid to talk about it due to fears of retribution from the government. The president's chief of staff recently resigned amidst reports in the press of several scandals involving his family. Unfortunately, this appears to be only the tip of the iceberg, as many other cases of corruption have been widely reported and substantiated. This has led to a strong level of outrage among many people in Panama, especially because of the fact that we do not have an independent criminal judicial system capable of investigating these serious allegations and bringing the culprits to trial. In summary, even though Panama has achieved impressive economic growth in the last 22 years, many challenges remain. It is my hope that these challenges will prove to be temporary, and that we as Panamanians will be smart enough and responsible enough to realize that unless we solve these problems, the current social and economic stability, which is the envy of our neighbors, will eventually unravel and lead to social upheaval and economic stagnation. Having said that, I would like to introduce my good friend, Vice President Varela, who will address you and discuss some of these matters.
Thanks, Jaime. Good morning. Mr. Stephen Johnson, Senior Fellow Director of SIS, Mr. Michael Chifter, President of Inter-American Dialogue, fellow Panamanian speakers, representative from the media here, ladies and gentlemen. I feel honored to have the opportunity to address such an engaged and committed audience to the best interests of the Western Hemisphere as you are, in the moments where democracy and institutions building have become top priorities for the region. I would like to thank the CSIS and Inter-American Dialogue for your interest in Panama and for having invited us to present you our vision of the country's reality. I come from a democratic country that is a geographic point of convergence and connection for the Americas and the world. Historically, Panama has been characterized as a place of encounters, tolerance, and dialogue to seek consensus for the region. The historic and orderly fashion transition of the canal to Panama in 1999 is one of the best examples of that spirit that defines the Panamanian people. After the Panamanian democracy was fully restored in 1990, the country focused on strengthening its democratic institutions, convinced as we are that within democratic states, the strength of democracy lies in the strength of their own institutions, as well as in the people's understanding of the advantage of this system, their ability to put democracy into practice and to obtain positive outcomes. Since the redemocratization of Panama, we have been able to enjoy what it's like to have an independent electoral tribunal, free and transparent elections with fast and reliable results acknowledged by all the political forces. Another endeavor that we undertook as a nation was to modernize our economy to make it more efficient within the changing international scenario. As it will be explained by other speakers who handle these issues very well, we have been very successful doing so. And as a result, the country has obtained an investment grade and remains to have a steady economic growth based on solid pillars that make our economy less vulnerable. Despite of this positive economic outlook and having one of the fastest growing economies in the Americas, it has failed to translate into a better quality of living for all Panamanians. And the bigger challenge that we face remains to be poverty and social inequality. Approximately 30% of the Panamanians live in poverty, 12% live in extreme poverty, and we are the second country with the most unequal distribution of income in the Americas, according to United Nations Human Development Index. If this issue is not properly and responsibly addressed by the Panamanian governments with a state vision, poverty may lead to increasing levels of social unrest, crime, and violence that will affect the country's good governance, hurt the Panamanian economy, and undermine our democratic system. With this in mind, I enter into politics with the goal of creating a balance between Panama's economic growth and the human development of the country. Therefore, as president of the Panamanista Party, I decided to enter into a coalition with the Cambio Democratico political party of President Ricardo Martinelli that led to the victory in 2009 elections. For 26 months, while being part of the government coalition, my team and I worked very hard to establish a government and social agenda aimed to tackle the roots of poverty in Panama with initiatives such as scholarships, affordable housing, and the 100 for 70 program, consisting of a monthly allowance for people over 70 years old who did not have social security. We also achieved a historical increase of the minimum wage to match Panama's inflation and high cost of living. Furthermore, we began social programs in the city of Panama and Colón as part of a strategy to prevent and reduce crime by improving housing conditions, security, and access to social services for hundreds of Panamanian families living in one of the most dangerous neighborhoods of the country. As former Minister of Foreign Affairs, my team and I also had the opportunity to redefine Panama's foreign policy to serve the needs of the country in other areas such as human rights, security, trade, regional integration, foreign investment, international cooperation, and sustainable development. Sadly, our government coalition fell apart due to the mistaken priorities of President Martinelli's administration, the lack of transparency and accountability over state resources, and the use of these resources by members of his own party for political gain, while trying to impose restrictions to freedom of expression. As a result, the Panamanista Party that I represent went to lead a constructive opposition, working together with the civil society and other parties to keep pushing the government to refocus its priorities in order to address the basic needs of the Panamanian people. Despite of all, the Panamanian democracy remains to be strong, and whenever a government attempts to undertake actions that could threaten our democratic system, the Panamanian people have come together and quickly responded to stop such threats. On June 19 of 2012, when the current government attempted to designate three additional judges of the Supreme Court in order to gain control of the judiciary, and the ruling party legislators tried to sell state-owned assets to cover a fiscal deficit and to get more cash for political gain, the Front for Democracy was created in order to defend Panama democratic systems and the heritage of the future generations. A few days later, as a result of the mobilizations of the Front for Democracy formed by opposition party leaders, workers, and representatives of more than 18 organizations of the civil society, President Martinelli and the Cambio Democratico Party were forced to repeal both of these laws. When the government launched a dirty campaign to deter journalists and members of the opposition from denouncing corruption scandals, the National Association of Journalists, the Panamanian media, and the civil society stood up together to participate in a march held on July 12th of this year to defend our freedom of expression. When the current government used state resources to run a dirty campaign of TV ads against the Front for Democracy and against my personal image, the Electoral Tribunal ordered the suspension of such TV ads on July 19 of 2012. When a group of workers of a construction company that has been granted millions through government contracts gathered to block the distribution outlets of La Prensa newspapers on August 3rd of 2012, the citizens rallied to support La Prensa, helping to get the newspaper out that same morning and putting the necessary pressure for the Office of the Attorney General to start a criminal investigation on these events. When a ruling party candidate was proven to have bought a local government election held in the district of Bebedero in the province of Los Santos, the Electoral Tribunal ruled to annul the results of this election on August 17 of 2012 and called for new elections. For the last month, President Martinelli and his legislative majority that was illegally obtained after having bought a group of opposition party legislators with state resources have been trying to pass a tailor-made electoral reform in order to benefit their own political party and manipulate the results of the 2014 elections. Despite the new series of mobilizations carried by the Front for Democracy throughout the country within last weeks, yesterday, the National Assembly, controlled by the ruling party of President Martinelli, chose to legislate in their own favor and advance the electoral reforms to third debate. The strong and united opposition from the Electoral Tribunal, representative of civil society, and each political parties of opposition have requested the president in numerous occasions to withdraw any legislation that changes the electoral rules so close to the next elections and fails to reflect the consensus of the people. This afternoon, the National Assembly will be guarded by the anti-riot squads of the police once again when the ruling party tries to impose the final approval of this electoral manipulation. No matter what, the will of the people will always prevail, and I remain confident that the Panamanian people will continue to defend our democracy against any threat imposed by this or any government. As a country, we have accomplished many goals, but there is still a long road ahead to consolidate our democratic system, which we believe is essential for the country and the society to achieve new sustainable stages of human development beyond our economic growth. I am confident that above all, the large majority of the Panamanian people are very aware of the convenience of going through this process to strengthen our democratic institutional framework. We do not agree with the president's attempt to concentrate political power in the hands of the executive and its intervention in other branches of the state. We do not believe in social confrontation. We do not believe in the imposition of government measures of any kind. And we do not believe in the absolute lack of transparency and government accountability over public funds. I strongly believe, as the majority of Panamanians, in the power of dialogue as the best mechanism to solve our differences and seek consensus. Over all things, I have faith in the Panamanian people, their love for the country, their values, as well as their hard work, entrepreneurship nature, and openness to the world. I have faith that we will be able to build a more fair and inclusive society for all Panamanians, where we can all enjoy the advantages of living in a full democracy. The democracy of a country is at risk only when its citizens are not willing to fight for it. And I can rest assured that the Panamanian people will do whatever it takes under the rule of law to protect and defend our democracy for the benefit of the present and future generations. For me, the most important part of the 2014 election is not the political race itself, but the national debate on how to find the best solutions to address the serious problems that affect the Panamanian people, and being able to have a state vision on key issues such as health, education, security, and corruption, among many others. I am part of a new generation of Panamanian political leaders, fully committed to help our country to play the role of capital city of the Americas, given by our geographic position, the Panama Canal, and our first-class logistic facilities, ports and airports. We will accomplish our mission towards our people, the region, and the world, fulfilling our destiny of being center of the world and heart of the universe. Thank you for coming today, and thank you for your interest in our country.
Thank you, Vice President Varela. Now please welcome Magistrate Gerardo Solis of Panama's Electoral Tribunal.
Thank you very much for being here. I will start by saying, what good does it make to you to have all the gold if you lose your ideals and your soul? We are a showcase. We are the Americans in Latin America. Panama was formed with the help of the United States. And the same year we attained the status of republic, the U.S. started building the canal. We have a corporate law that was enacted in 1927, I believe, and we have the same corporate law. We have had four constitutions. What is important is the rule of law. Vice President Varela just started by saying that. And I believe that is the most important thing we need to focus on, the rule of law in Panama. And what is the actual context? After the construction of the canal, for half a century, we had lots of frauds. I don't believe we had one or two, I would say, fair and just elections. We suffer many U.S. interventions in Panama to put order, most of them requested by the Panamanians. The last one, Operation Just Cause, opens the door for prosperity, for progress, and for democracy. But what is the actual contest? We have lived in a consistent improvement of the electoral laws. We have a consensus through the civil society and the electoral court, the political parties, the universities, the Catholic Church, which is ranked number one in credibility in Panama. And as of the year 2009, it's perceived a weakening in the institutionality of our democracy. What is the Electoral Court? It's an institution aside from the government. It's a state institution. It's an institution of the nation. We don't belong to the government. We are three justices, one by each a branch of the government, and we're supposed to be impartial, and we're supposed to act objectively, and we are the ones who do the elections. We organize the elections. We keep the records of all the citizens. We issue the ID, the national ID card. We issue that document. and we have the record of all the people who vote. We organize the election, and we give the results of the election quick. And since 1990 up until 2009, all the losers, as soon as we say who won, in an unofficial transmission of results, the loser respect and recognize the winner. And we also have exclusive jurisdiction on electoral matters. We decide the conflicts on electoral matters. For the first time in our history, in 2009, the Supreme Court started to extend their jurisdiction and a constitutional interpretation over the electoral laws. We have exclusive constitutional right to construct the electoral law. This was the case where seven members of the ruling party, Cambio Democrático, wanted to go to Parlacen, the Central American Parliament, and they did not participate in the election, but the Supreme Court told us, your decision was wrong, you have to issue credentials to these seven guys so they can go to the Parlacen. I believe that up to now, we had to issue the credentials in 1910 and in 2010, but I believe that up to, until now, Parlacen has not accepted them there. They didn't run. In 2010, the national legislature made impossible the application of a law that would make impossible the changing of parties. As of that moment, the government attained majority. CD, Cambio Democrático, obtained majority in the legislature. It's impossible to forbid the senators to change parties, so they change at will now. In 2010, the Supreme Court also ruled against an old law that said that no person can hold two jobs, elected jobs, at the same time. You can run to two, three jobs at the same time, but if you win, you have to choose which one you're gonna hold. The Supreme Court issued a ruling 2 years ago saying that you can hold both or three jobs if you are elected to those. That happened to solve a particular political problem in one place where one senator wanted also to hold the job of congressman. And he's actually three senators are holding more than two jobs. The former president of the legislature, the actual president of the legislature, and another government senator. In 2012, the Electoral Court rejected the merger of the political party Molirena and Cambio Democrático. And at that moment begins the ill will of the governmental party against the justices of the Electoral Court. In 2011, December, we had an election, partial election of a Congress person in a very small community. Not important at all. It won't change anything. The governmental, the official candidate was a well-known and very liked former teacher, retired teacher. But the government did use officials' monies in that election to ensure that she will win the election. The Electoral Court ruled a couple of days ago in the findings that it was proven that the government did use official monies to assist her to win that elections. I cannot further comment, Vice President Varela just mentioned the name, Bebedero is the name of the community. I cannot keep commenting on the future of the decision because they requested a reconsideration to that decision, and one of my colleagues is the one that have to decide that recourse. During 2011, the Electoral Court publicly opposed the dangerous initiative of a unconstitutional balloting or second round for electing the president, unprecedented in Panama. For 100 years, we have had the same electoral system than the United States. Just one election, you win by majority. The government tried to pass a law that will require a second election to decide who is going to be the president in 2014. That unfortunate initiative produced the abandonment of the improvement to the electoral law that was agreed upon with the society. In 2012, this year, people manifested themselves publicly in the street against the creation of a new courtroom in the Supreme Court under the perception that it had a concealed intent to allow the re-election by ways of or means of constructing the electoral law in a way that will allow the re-election of the president. In 2012, the government party submitted its own unilateral reform to the law. Where do you see a player changing the rules during the game to benefit its own side? This is not rule of law. In 2012, President Ricardo Martinelli requested personally the Supreme Court to separate, destitute, and condemn the three justices of the Supreme Electoral Court, myself and my colleagues, and our deputies. So he will have the opportunity to replace the whole court by just one decision of the Supreme Court. Fortunately, the public networks on a Sunday were so crowded that day the president had to call the three justices and ask for forgiveness, I say, and tell us that he will withdraw on Monday the request to the Supreme Court. And he did, but the court hasn't decided it yet. So it's still pending there, that decision. What happened if you're playing a game and during the game the referee has to be blowing the whistle? Or if you're in a fight and you pull your trunk a little higher and you lower your opponent and the referee is telling you that you're not doing the right thing, you're not doing a fair competition, you don't like the referee. And a discredit campaign against the Electoral Court has started. In 2012, I will have to say, to honor the presence of Minister Frank de Lima, for the first time ever, and I have to thank you very much in public, 100% of our budget was approved for the next year. Never in the history of the Electoral Court, the budget has been approved like that. And I also have to say, to honor fairness, President Ricardo Martinelli is allowing the Electoral Court to build an icon structure that will represent the will of the Panamanian people for democracy. We are building a new Electoral Court that is going to be a landmark that tourists and Panamanians will feel proud of our democracy. What are the challenges that we are facing? Well, my term is due in less than 2 months, and the Supreme Court has to appoint my replacement. I'm not running for re-election, so the Supreme Court has to select someone that will have enough credibility. Right now, the credibility of the Electoral Court is second changing places, third and second, with the canon authority. We are second to the Catholic Church, which is the number one rank in credibility. So the Supreme Court has a challenge to find a replacement that will represent a guarantee for the people that the next election will be like the other election we have had. The greatest challenge that I foresee is to make officials understand that public funds cannot be used to support their candidates. That's the biggest challenge we have. How we're gonna do that? Well, I think we can make it by creating consciousness in the city, educating citizens, granting monies to non-governmental organizations to help them promote the goodwill of this system that we learned 100 years ago, which is the American way, which is not buying and selling. The American way is the way of democracy. If we understand, if we make everybody understand that progress is what we all want, economic prosperity, but we also need to be able to obtain public good standing in society, and the political power have to be accessible to all, not only to the higher level, have to be accessible to all, we're going to be able to move forward and make grow our democracy. At the end, Panama is like a bottle cork, we say. Doesn't matter what happened in Panama. We always come out floating because we are a melting pot of races. We are happy people. We are a people that we never had a war. And if, wherever you go, you find a merry-go-round people that they're, you know, whoever knows Panamanians knows that we like things the easy way. We have never had to fight a war that make us hate each other. We are basically, since the Spanish, since the original inhabitants of America, they went to Panama to trade. The Spanish also trade with the Colon, with the Portobello trade zones and the Colon free zones. So what merchants want? They want peace. They don't like turmoil and revolutions. Therefore, I believe that at the end, like Vice President Varela said, the will of the people, our idiosyncrasy will prevail, and the good will always come on top. Thank you very much. I should have started by saying that what John Adams, I believe, said. I never checked this quote, but I liked it at the beginning of the presentation. An unchecked democracy is the most detestable form of government because it takes away all the hope from the people. Thank you.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Guillermo Adames, president of the National Council of Journalism.
Good morning. For many years, it has been my privilege to be involved in various elements of our media. For example, as an owner of a national radio station, director of a national newspaper, host for prestigious television programs and radio programs, and also as president of the National Journalism Council. Throughout my career, I have observed many presidents come and go. and have noted some interesting patterns in the Panamanians' politicians' relationship with the media. It has consistently demonstrated a classic love and hate relationship. Now, some of our friends of journalism and media when they are in the opposition. However, as soon as they got the power, or get to power, they undergo a chameleon-like change. Sometimes, even becoming our worst enemies, they forget that morals should be the same both while in power and when in opposition, and they become allergic to any dissident. This is not a positive time for the Panamanian journalism. Even with our delicate freedom of speech, journalism and journalists and the media must pay a high price to report or denounce corruption. Our leaders systematically reject accountability and repeatedly attempt to mutilate the media's right to inform and the public's right to be informed. Accountability is the counterbalance of power. One of the most strident criticisms that Panamanian society makes to our current administration, according to the national polls, it's not my position, it's the national polls says that those are very institutional, responsible for making our leaders acceptable for their actions, like the Comptroller General of or the Assembly of Deputies, have been effectively captured and controlled. Same applies to the Supreme Court and the public ministry. All are now subject to the pressures of supreme executive powers. That's what our poll says. Until now, the Electoral Tribunal, where his president is here, has remained independent. Given the lack of supervision by the entities responsible for enforcing this delicate mission of accountability, and because the internal institutional controls have been deactivated, it has fallen to the media to fill the void of by practicing a journalism of a denouncement equable, but firm. A culture of fear has been promoted as the means to silence independent journalism and media. The administration uses state institutions, such as the tax authority, to prevent journalistic enterprises, from divulging scandals, many of profound media impact. Nowadays, circumventing the scrutiny of society has become a common practice. In order to accomplish this, the independent media must be silenced. Media have been acquired by some high-ranking public officials and their collaborators, being subsequently utilized as venomous shock troops to attack independent journalism and media. For this, they provide voice to propagandists of lies, mud chroniclers, burmistrers of reputations, and flatterers of political power. Television stations, whose owners are allied with the regime of the moment, recur with fervent ferocity to morally discredit any who disagree, to them, these are enemies, not adversaries. They suffer unyielding stubbornness to malign any citizen who disagree, forgetting that the credibility of the journalistic profession is based upon an independence, upon its independence, I'm sorry. The media only provides a reflection of the country, and it is, and as it is, the average Panamanian desires to know the truth, and that murky activity from our leaders be denounced, that's important. Panama is poisoned by the lies of some politicians in power and in opposition. The media must report those events that either good or bad are of a general interest. They serve as the sounding board for the accumulated anger of the populace. The democracy is a regime measured by the degree of freedom of expressions that can be exercised without suffering retaliation or intimidation. The government must base its relationship with the media and journalism upon respect for political and ideological pluralism, while refraining from shameful episodes of intolerance and authoritarianism. The statement publicly issued by the National Journalistic Council during my presidency on October 5, 2010, denounced that among the government's strategies to silence the media, there was the abominable return of criminalizing criticism and comments and the opinions from all hierarchical levels throughout the media hewn over the willful misconduct of public officials. Our statement added that Article 184 of the Penal Code clearly expresses that without bias to Articles 189 and 119 of this code, discussions, criticism, and opinions amongst others regarding the acts of or official commissions by public officials relative to the exercise of their functions do not constitute offenses against the honor, just as literally artistic, historical, scientific, or professional criticism. I denounced at that time, and I reiterated today that based upon factual evidence, there exists a desire to develop a pseudo-legal shield of criminal coercion that threatens the exercise of journalistic criticism and transforms public officials of all levels into privileged and irresponsible officials. The intent was to deprive of their freedom and journalistic any journalist who would promote the transparency and honor of public administration. I now refer to various reports from Panamanian journalistic organizations and media have presented to various international organizations, including the American Commission of Human Rights, and these are only a few. I'm going on to detail, as I said, a few cases of persecution or intimidation to journalists for denouncing acts of corruption in the current administration. For example, for RPC Television, which is Channel 4, a journalist called Juan Carlos Tapia was threatened, and inspectors of the tax authority were sent to his company. Alvaro Alvarado, a journalist from the same TV station, denounced that he was called to the public ministry for intimidation, as well as receiving serious threats and being objected to campaigns of discreditation by media affiliated to the government, as well as through the internet, they do the same thing. Journalist of Telemetro, Channel 13, his name is Jose Garibaldi, was assaulted by a legislator or a senator of the governing party in the elections celebrated in a small rural town because he uncovered information about the possible buying of votes at the electoral tribunal by the governing party. That's the same place the vice president mentioned a few minutes ago. Now, a one-year prison sentence and the disqualification to service or to exercise the journalistic profession were imposed to the director of news of TVN Channel 2, Sabrina Bacal, and to other journalists named Justino Gonzalez. Journalists Siria Miranda, Eduardo Lim Yuen, and Kellynet Perez were summoned to a criminal trial for projecting a video of a citizen's report of a police officer allegedly asking for bribes from a driver. The current director of news of Channel 2, Guido Rodriguez, has also received threats for criticizing the government. Discreditation and intimidation campaigns have been directed against Lina Vega and Santiago Cumbreras, journalists of newspaper La Prensa, for investigating alleged cases of corruption and denouncing them. The director of the Tourism Authority filed a suit against Monica Palm, a journalist of the same newspaper, for questioning certain actions of a said official. The ex-president and founder of Diario La Prensa, Roberto Eisenman, denounced the sending of tax authority officials to his private company as a retaliation for his criticism of the current government. Some foreign journalists currently settled in Panama has also been affected, as shown by reports of organisms of the press presented to international organizations. Among the outstanding cases is that of the Spanish journalist Paco Gomez Nadal, who was expelled from our country, as well as the case of the colleagues of the Canadian Change CBC, who were denied entry to the country to make a news report about mining in Panama. All this is proved by the media, by the television, the radio, and everything. The scathing speeches from the president and some ministers against media and journalists have united in a common front. The archaic governing stratagems stifle any sympathies toward the government. This is clearly evident as in the results of professional polls which demonstrate how the public's credibility of most public officials and of public institutions has sharply plunged. The independence of the media and journalists in denouncing the murky actions of the ruling power bears the intent that transparency within government activities extend to its darkest corners. This is non-negotiable. Political corruption is like a wound that no government has eradicated. On the contrary, it here seems to have gangrened. The building of Panama's democracy is still a work in progress, one crying out for committed hands. Finally, I would like to conclude on an optimistic note. I hope I hope the president of Panama decides to correct any and amend the excesses that have taken place against the media and the journalists and the freedom of speech, and that he put an end to the intimidation and persecution against those of us who practice journalism seriously and with the sole interest in the progress, peace, and tranquility of our country. Because ruling... Because ruling, that's very usual in Panama. Because ruling, according to Confucius, implies rectifying. If this does not happen, we are aware that is our responsibility to defend freedom of speech and democracy every day, at any cost, because we know that freedom of speech is the most essential and keystone of them all. Its loss will prevent us from defending any other. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm certainly glad that Guillermo did not candy coat any of that. And I'd like to move on now to welcome Guillermo Chapman, chairman of Indesa, a privately held finance corporation in Panama, to take a look at the business climate there, which is remarkably vibrant.
Thank you, Steve. Good morning to you all. It's an honor and a pleasure to participate in this program sponsored by such prestigious organizations as the CSIS and the Inter-American Dialogue, and to share the podium with such distinguished guests. My subjects this morning will change tack a little bit. We're going to talk about the economy this time, and the subject is there. Panama has been, is, and as I see it, will continue to be a vibrant and dynamic economy. And I will try to cover the subject in four basic areas. What the facts are, what the drivers have been, what are the threats and the potentials. The facts. In the last decade, we have grown at a compound rate of almost 7%. And in the last 6 years, close to 9%, which is a fast, sustained rate, compounded of real growth of gross domestic product. Last year, it was over 10% real growth. This year, we will repeat that. Is substantially higher than continental China, probably one or two countries in the world are in that league, maybe Mongolia and some other country I don't know of. Nobody in the Americas growing at that rate. And this is the result of many forces. In our model, the model we have developed in our firm, the main driver is exports of goods and services. We are a very small economy. Exports represent about 4/5 of gross domestic, of gross aggregate demand, which is the largest chunk of total demand, and this is the big locomotive moving the economy. And out of total exports, which in the past 6 years grew at close to 12% real terms, services take the lion's share. And then I don't have it in the graphs, consumption, which are also a substantial part. And then, sorry, this is 40%, consumption is another 40%, and then investment, which is about 20% of aggregate demand and about 20%, 25% last year of GDP, which has been growing parallel to GDP, but a little faster in the past 6 years than GDP, and which takes some 25% of GDP. Not as high as some of the countries which dedicate about 75% of GDP in fixed capital formation. About 25 is a good chunk. And the government, including the Canal Authority, puts in about a little over 8% of GDP. So the message is we are investing substantially, but the private sector is putting up the lion's share of investment. So there are several factors. And in the social area, the results are usually caused by several factors. It's an oversimplification to say this element explains everything. And then we cannot lose sight of the fact that we have a big gap in the current account of the balance of payments, especially since when the economy began growing very fast, the current account has been in deficit from 6% to 12%. Any economist coming first time to Panama from the World Bank or from the IMS, we say, gosh, my gosh, you have a really big hole. You have to do something about it. Well, it's a problem of the chicken and the egg, because many times, the gap is caused by the red line, by the foreign direct investment. Out of this investment, it's not housing. It's really machinery and equipment and ports and hydroelectrics and really a capacity that's added to the production capacity of the country, and many is financed by foreign investment. And this includes the movement of capital, which requires imports. So it moves capital into the country, but it requires imports. So it's reflected on both sides. It provides its own financing so far. But it tells us another message. We don't save enough. And we are dependent on foreign capital, not only in direct foreign investment, but also in debt, which is banks and public sector debt, which in certain periods, like in the crisis of 88 and in the great recession of 2009, in one time it brought the economy to a severe depression, and now to a substantial deceleration of the economy, has produced negative results. And I'll make a note of that later. And one of the positive consequences is that inflation, which by the international comparable standard, which is the so-called open unemployment, was 12% at the beginning of the previous decade, is now in the order of 3%. We are in full employment. Now, part of this is people who somebody hires, pays them a salary, has social security protection, and people who work on their own. Many of them don't draw a salary and don't have the protection of the social network and are really a marginal on a subsistence level. And then the other side of the coin is inflation. It started really accelerating in 2005 with the overheating of the economy. One thing brings the other. The overheating of the economy and the overshooting of world prices, and it's associated with fast rate of growth and the import prices. And it's nowadays about 6%, and the projection for this year is 6%. Our structure, economic structure, is unique. Agriculture is very small as compared to Central America and Colombia. Manufacturing is very small, single digit, as compared, again, to our two neighboring regions, Central America and Colombia. Commerce is very big. Transportation and communications, which includes the canal. Aviation, which is much larger than the canal. Communications, which is a large sector. So when you combine commerce and transportation and financial intermediation with services, it gives you what the Panamanian economy is like. It's very unique. Is very similar to a developed economy when you compare it to the other typical economies. So this is how we have performed and how we are in a nutshell. The drivers. First of all, what the modern analysts call self-discovery. We were blocked from using the hinterland of the canal by the Canal Treaty of 1903. It was the treaty provided that the canal and its surrounding areas, the so-called canal zone, was for purposes of building the canal, operating the canal, protecting the canal, and we could not use it for development purposes. So we went into what the literature calls a process of self-discovery. We have to use our geographic position. What are we going to do it? So we invented many things. And here is a list. We adopted the US dollar as legal tender. We created a sound public registry and a cheap registration law. And people from all over the world started registering their vessels on the Panamanian flag, a modern corporate law, which Magistrate Solis just mentioned, the Colón Free Zone, which is the largest free trade zone in the Western Hemisphere nowadays and brings in a lot of foreign exchange to Panama, a very flexible tax legislation, modern banking legislation, which has developed in a banking center for the country, reinsurance law, the Panama Canal Treaty in 1977, providing for the return of the canal to under Panamanian control, trust law, oil-free zones, private interest foundations, a key element, the privatization of ports and utilities. I'll mention that in a moment. Full control of the canal in 1999, the Howard Special Economic Zone, which is another sort of free zone on the Pacific side, but with industry, manufacturing, assembly, an airport next to the port, and taking off very nicely, and the aviation hub of the Americas, which is another very interesting development. Okay, let's see if I can handle this now. Now, and then another factor behind this is a package of public policies adopted in the mid-1990s, which changed the economic mindset which the military governments had adopted during their 21-year regime, which in essence opened up the economy again. I did include in a reduction of import duties by 30% on average across the board, and changing the so-called per specific to ad valorem of many items which had per specific duties which were prohibitive to ad valorem. The privatization of ports and utilities, all of which were managed by the state, with the exception of water supply, which is still managed by the state. The coming to terms with the public debt overhang. The military had put the country in hock up to our ears, and the first administration after the invasion had let the commercial debt unpaid. There were accumulated interest for close to 10 years, and the whole thing had to be clear, so the debt was renegotiated, and first under the Brady scheme, and then over a normal procedure. The elimination of exclusivity to investments, investment incentives. There was a so-called sort of club, and the thing was opened up, and everybody had access to all the incentives on equal terms. And finally, we got to balanced budgets and surpluses. And then there was the devolution of lands adjacent to the canal and other properties, assets, and the canal itself. And it meant a shot in the arm to the economy equivalent to 6% of GDP, which was put to very good use for ports, industries, all sort of development. The whole package has meant a boost to development for this decade that explains a lot of what is happening to the Panamanian economy and the entrepreneurship of the Panamanians. The milestones, okay, let's mention the threats now. We have a very poor income distribution with a Gini coefficient of 52. I think only Chile is worse than us in the continent. A very limited human resources skills pool, which, among other things, is a result of a very bad, I said poor, which is a poor choice of words, a very bad public educational system, and a very bad training system for work. And some activities For instance, we know that some hotels cannot really fully utilize their capacity because there are no trained workers, and some industries that could develop cannot develop unless we develop some sort of scheme to train the workers. Part of the explanation of why agriculture is shrinking faster than it should be as a percentage of GDP is that we don't have an agricultural strategy. And we are increasing our dependence on imports. Well, I already mentioned the lack of domestic savings and dependence on foreign direct investment and credit, and the danger that the economy could come to a sudden stop, and then inflation and the loss of real income. Let me end by mentioning the potential of the economy. I see the potential as the perspective as very positive. There are serious threats, but they're manageable. The expansion of the canal, which is going on at the present, opens new and very positive vistas for additional activities and revenue. And parallel with this expanded waterway, a world-class logistics industry is beginning to develop. Tourism is another industry very promising. There are possibilities in agriculture, provided we adopt a sound strategy. There are also additional possibilities for the aviation hub and a financial center. The financial, the economic model, which is questioned by many analysts, especially from the left, in my view, is sustainable, but it requires adjustments. And let me say by ending, the Panamanians have been throughout history a peace-loving, hard-working people who could make all of this possible. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Guillermo Chapman, Chairman of Indesa. And finally, please welcome Minister of Economy, Frank De Lima, for the final word.
Good morning. I know I have a presentation. I'm supposed to talk about Panama's economy, but as the only government representative, I would like to address some of the issues that were raised before by the prior speakers. Former Ambassador Alemán mentioned security and drug trafficking and organized crime in Panama. I think we all recognize the advances that have been made in this administration. For example, in the previous administration, in total, they invested about $30 million in security. And in President Martinelli's administration, we'll be investing over $450 million in security for radars, ships, helicopters, et cetera. We've been working closely with Homeland Security. Also, there's a lot of collaboration between the Panamanian government, the Colombian government, the Mexican government, and obviously the American government. Little known fact, Panama was the country with the third highest decommission of cocaine in the world last year behind the United States. And Mexico, I think, was the second. Education, also former Minister Chapman mentioned education. For 30 years, we've been talking about the need for curriculum transformation or modernization in Panama. That is taking effect now with the leadership of Minister Lucy Molinar. If we look back in the previous administration, we had, unfortunately, four education ministers in a five-year period. So obviously we had some setbacks there. We're investing heavily and also in new schools, a new laptop for the private school students. And to me, which is probably the most important government program that has been established in this administration, the Universal Scholarship, where we're giving a $20 a month scholarship to kids in private, in public schools and some private schools, as long as they maintain a C average, as long as their parents go and meet with their teachers so they become involved in their child's education. And that has helped combat the school desertion that existed. 50% of kids that finished elementary school did not finish high school. So we're working to combat that with this program. Corruption was mentioned also. Recently, the World Economic Forum published a competitiveness index where Panama was ranked number 40 in the world. We're the second most competitive economy. We increased our ranking by 9 positions. And in all the indicators dealing with corruption, Panama showed improvement. There's a lot more room for improvement, we admit, but I think the tendency is that we are doing a lot in that sense. Politics. Let's talk a little bit about politics. For 20 years, since 1989 to 2009, Panama was a two-party system with smaller satellite political parties, PRD and the Panamanista Party, the alternated power. In 2009, that political paradigm was broken. A third-party candidate won the election. And now what we're seeing is this political gamesmanship going on right now, and we're talking about, the reforms to the electoral process. The elections in Panama are in May of 2014, more than 18 months away. To say that it's too early, I mean, it's too late to change the rules of the game, I disagree respectfully with the president of the Tribunal Board. Most of the reforms that have been approved in the Congress were reforms that were included in the proposed package that was developed by the Tribunal electorate. For example, we have circuits or districts where you vote for more than one representative, which are called the plurinominales. For example, in the area of San Miguelito, you vote for 7 persons. With the current system, they have what you call the voto plancha. You vote for the political party. So one vote is counted 7 times. That doesn't sound too democratic to me. So what we're doing is changing it to one person, one vote. And that way, that would be more representative than the current system. For example, in 2004, the PRD party received 38% of the votes for their congressmen, but they had 52% of the Congress. So where's the representation? Also, something that was briefly touched upon, and as a representative of the government, I would like to address, is as the vice president mentioned, you know, I said I'm the only government official. Mr. Varela is vice president of the country, but after the coalition broke up last year, Mr. Varela has become the biggest critic of the government. So, to put that in perspective, it would be as if Rush Limbaugh or Bill O'Reilly would be vice president of President Obama. But no offense, vice president. But the truth is, we're treading on some of the decisions that the Tribunal electorate has made recently. For example, with censorship, a group affiliated to the government put up an ad criticizing the vice president. The Tribunal electorate took it down. The United States is in a electoral process right now, and you see all the political ads where candidates are defined by what they said in the past or what they've done. And I think that's something that the electorate needs to know where candidates stand. Right now, I can mention an example of flip-flopping by the vice president when he mentioned that his movement, the Frente Antidemocratico, fought against the sale of government assets. What he didn't mention was that in this year's budget that was prepared last year by the former Minister of Economy, which is the vice president of his political party, included the sale of those assets, which was approved in cabinet by himself and the other ministers of his political party, and was approved also in Congress by his members of the Congress. But now they're against it. So just, I think this sort of flip-flopping is something that needs to be included in a campaign so the candidates can be defined. And also they mentioned the case of Bebedero, which was an elected official, a representative. In 2009, the person that won was of the government party, Cambio Democrático. Unfortunately, that person died in a car accident. New elections were called, and the government's candidate won with 627 votes. The PRD, the opposition candidate, received 278 votes. And it was mentioned the government's candidate was a former school teacher. The PRD's candidate was a former guerrilla who fought in Nicaragua. I mean, who would you ask? Who would you vote for, honestly, when if you came at the moment? So we still don't agree with also the decision that was taken to annul that election and call for a new election. Okay, now we'll talk about the economy. I'll go briefly because former Minister Chapman did a very good job of explaining. As mentioned, Panama's economy grew 10.6% last year, the highest growth rate in all of Latin America. We expect to grow at 10% this year. And as you see, if you compare to our peers, Brazil, Colombia, Mexico, Peru, we have at least almost double the economic growth that they're experimenting. Even though we have obviously a crisis in Europe, the IMF indicates that Latin America as a whole is, you know, the impact of the euro crisis will be minimal. And that's why we maintain our estimates that we will have this double-digit growth this year, and we expect to grow 8.5% in year 2013. As mentioned, unemployment has reached its historical low. Open unemployment is 2.9%. Unemployment 4.5%. If you ask anyone in the private sector, they will tell you that their main problem is getting labor, qualified labor at all levels, managerial level, middle management, including people that stock shelves. We're having trouble finding that type of labor. The key, as mentioned by Mr. Chapman, is the key to economics, a strong economic growth is the diversity of our economy. No sector of economy represents more than 25% of GDP. Obviously, the canal, I know we're supposed to talk besides the canal, but the canal is fundamental, and especially the other activities around the canal, for example, the port system, obviously the our financial center. As you see, financial intermediaries with 9%, transportation, storage, and communications, 25%, real estate, business, 14%, et cetera. This strong economic growth has had positive social effects also. Mean GDP improved almost 45% since 2004. It has increased close to $230 a month. And poverty has decreased from 38.3%. Well, this graph doesn't include the figures for 2012. Poverty at 2012 is at 25.8%. And extreme poverty is at 10.4%. So we've seen the impact that these economic growth that Panama's had over the last couple of years in helping reduce poverty and improving the average wages. When this administration took office, we hired McKinsey and Company to help us develop our strategic plan. What we looked at was what areas of the Panama had competitive and comparative advantages, obviously, logistics, tourism, and financial services. So our investment program was structured in a way that we would help increase the potential of these three areas, which would be the drivers for job creation and for economic growth. Obviously, those who've had experience working with McKinsey know the famous moons. And there we see, where we have obviously logistics with the Panama Canal, tourism with our diversity, financial services, and which of these areas also does the government have an influence to be able to maximize the potential. And we have future potentials, for example, offshoring services, maritime services, and for example, Panama becoming a medical tourism destination as Colombia and other countries in their region. Also, Panama last year received a little bit over 2 million visitors or tourists. Hopefully this year we'll be able to maintain our 10% growth. We'll be at 2.2%, and we'll soon catch up to Costa Rica and pass Costa Rica. And if you ask, you know, 10 years ago, Costa Rica was light years ahead of Panama in tourism activity, and we'll surpass them. Logistics, when the ports were privatized back in 97, the Panamanian ports moved 250,000 containers a year. Last year they moved 6.6 million containers a year. So it just shows the strong growth we've had in our port system. We're also opening up two new ports, and one of them will be developed by the Panama Canal Authority, hopefully. Also the increase in the tolls that the Panama Canal receives, and also the strength of our financial center, as you see the growth in assets over the last couple of years. Panama had a 2.3 fiscal deficit last year, and their fiscal responsibility law, which puts a cap on how much the fiscal deficit can be, established at 3%. And the first semester of 2012, we closed with a 1.2 fiscal deficit, and the law permits a 2.9% deficit for this year. If we compare to other countries, what our fiscal performance was, like I mentioned, Panama 2.3, the United States was 8.2. Spain 9.3, Japan close to 9% also. And the reason we've been running deficits is because of the strong, well, first of all, the debt to GDP ratio also that was previously mentioned. We've gone down from 71%, we're at 41.8 at the end of 2011, and we expect to close below 41% at 2012. And what have we been doing with this, with the debt we've been contracting? Is we've been spending it in public investment. Public investment was 8.8% of GDP last year. This administration will be investing a little bit over $13 billion. That does not include the $5.25 billion of the Panama Canal expansion program. The previous administration invested $4.4 billion. So we're seeing in a five-year period an almost 300% increase in public investment. As you can tell, for every dollar in debt from the period 2000-2004, $1.14 was financed with debt. In the period 2005 to 2009, for every dollar of investment, 46 cents of it was financed with debt. And this administration, with every dollar of investment, 26 cents of it is being financed with debt. Recently, we created a sovereign wealth fund, which we call the Panama Savings Fund, that is going to capture the excess revenue that the Panama Canal is going to generate after the expansion is completed at the end of 2014. And the purpose of this sovereign wealth fund, or the Panama Savings Fund, is for economic stabilization in predetermined cases. For example, when we have natural disasters that cause damage above 0.5% of GDP, in today's terms, it would be over $150 million. Our GDP is close to $30 billion, a little bit more. And then the government can ask for a waiver and use the monies or the capital in the sovereign wealth fund to help cover the cost of rebuilding or reconstruction. And when we have economic downturn or recession, we define that as when the economy grows less than 2% for two quarters consecutively, then also the government can implement a countercyclical investment program to reactivate the economy using the monies from the sovereign wealth fund. And I think, to me, this is the most impressive graphic of all, of the evolution of our economy, of the capacity of the government in the future to invest. As I mentioned, our economy at the end of 2011 was a little bit over $30 billion. At the end of this year, it's going to be $34 billion. By 2025, Panama's economy should be over $100 billion. And you see the evolution of our debt to GDP will be below 22% by the year 2025. If the following governments maintain the fiscal deficits that are contemplated in our fiscal responsibility law. And if we add to that the monies that will be accumulated in the sovereign wealth fund, Panama will have a net debt to GDP percentage of 16.2%. And also you see the evolution of the CapEx, or the public investment capacity, that the future governments will have. The next administration will have the capacity to invest $19 billion. Which is almost 50% more than what this administration will be investing. Some final conclusions. Panama has demonstrated a robust, sustained economic growth, and is currently exceeding economic growth averages both regionally and globally. This growth goes together with the responsible fiscal policies. The debt to GDP ratio keeps falling. The IMF recently published a study that it contemplates that Panama will have the highest economic growth in the region for the next 5 years. We've, like I said, we improved to number 40 in the Global Competitiveness Report. We've improved 19 positions in the 3 years of the President Martin Lee's administration. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Minister De Lima. Now for the really interesting, this has been very interesting as well. This has been like a town meeting, and I hope you've gotten a sense of the range of opinions and points of view represented by various people in government and as well as out of government. Now I'd like to call on Michael Shifter to come up and deliver some brief thoughts on this discussion and open our question and answer session. Michael?
Well, good morning to everybody, and thank you, Steve. It's been a real pleasure to collaborate with you and with CSIS. I also want to thank Michael Grable, who's really was helped put this event together and has done a terrific job. And I also want to thank Hami Aleman for his tremendous support and guidance in really making this possible. So thank you very much. Ambassador Jaramillo, I want to thank as well, and Guillermo Coches, who's the ambassador to the Organization of American States from Panama. And I want to thank these terrific speakers who have joined us. Last night we met first for dinner, and they asked me, you know, what advice could I give? And I said, I think you should just be honest and say what's on your mind, but I didn't expect that they would listen to me. Because that rarely happens, but in this case, they actually listened to me. So I think this was a very, very frank and useful conversation. Let me just say, for the Inter-American Dialogue, this event is extremely important. This year, we're celebrating our 30th anniversary of the dialogue. And our founding chair of the Inter-American Dialogue was Ambassador Saul Linowitz, who was one of the negotiators of the Panama Canal Treaty in 1977, 5 years before the dialogue started. When we honor him, we also honor one of his greatest accomplishments. This session is entitled Beyond the Panama Canal, but in some ways it struck me that the comments were almost too modest and understated this morning about the really remarkable performance of the canal and the prospects for its continued outstanding performance. I would even put more of an emphasis on that than I know the Panamanians are very modest, but I'll do that. And also just the extraordinary growth and dynamism of the economy. This was raised at the end by Minister De Lima and also Guillermo Chapman, but really if one looks at it from a distance, it's quite stunning and impressive. I was talking to a colleague from Singapore the other day, and he said, you know, we're from Singapore, we're like the Panama of Asia, he said. This is quite an impressive story in Panama. But at the same time, we have the strength of the economy, the canal, and the other drivers of the economy that Minister De Lima mentioned. But there are obviously real challenges that came out in this discussion this morning, and not only in terms of sustaining the economic growth, but also in dealing with questions of inequality, poverty, and we all know from the data that the best way to overcome these problems is through a better education system. And I hope that Minister De Lima, the encouraging comments he gave on some of the reforms and changes that are taking place in education, really take hold, because I think that would make a tremendous difference. Other speakers emphasized some of the institutional challenges, concerns about the erosion in the rule of law, concerns about freedom of the press. These are soft spots that came out of the discussion, I think, this morning, the politicization of the judicial sector, which is, of course, is not peculiar to Panama. And I'm sure as all of you, like me, kept thinking as we were listening to these great speakers that this is, well, you know, this is also true in a number of other countries in the region and also in the United States to different degrees and so forth, but this is not, these problems which were focused on Panama are not entirely peculiar to Panama. Let me just pose two questions and then I'm going to open it up to all of you. We have roughly a half hour and I want to just get as many comments and questions out there as possible. We have a terrific group this morning, but it just strikes me the two questions that are really relevant are, one is, you know, has Panama always been this way? In other words, some of these institutional concerns, the poverty inequality, is there something really that's really significantly different about this government than previous governments, or is this the way it's kind of been and has been, and what sort of distinguished between what's been there for a long time to what's really been new in Panama in the last couple of years? And second, which is a question that I think a lot of countries are asking, is can this be sustained? In other words, the vibrancy, the dynamism of the economy, the growth of the economy, and the kind of political malaise in some ways, institutional concerns, some sense of erosion of checks and balances and the like. Is this somehow going to really could produce a crisis, or could one imagine that this will just continue to go on, the sort of the economy going strong and the political challenges? And I think that's, if one looks around the region, I think there are a number of other countries that are also asking that question. Anyway, those are two questions. What I would like to do is open it up to all of you. Please identify yourselves. Please be brief. And we're going to try to get as many questions as we can. We'll start with Steve Donahue, and then Ambassador, I see you. We'll go to you afterwards. Please wait for the microphone. So,
good morning, and thank you, Stephen Donahue from McClarty Associates. A very interesting and almost fun to listen to, if it weren't so embarrassing to see the level of discord that exists among our friends from Panama. How about now? It's about as close as it can get. Okay. One of the things that investors really look at, and y'all have been very successful so far, is transparency and a level playing field and a rule of law. And the challenge that we're seeing this week in Panama's political system is the way that the political reforms that y'all have talked about are holding up action in the Panamanian legislature. One of the things that it's holding up is passage of the free trade agreement, which we all care about. One of the reasons we care about it is not because there's going to be all that much more trade between our countries, but because it sets into place some rules for investors and some guarantees for investors. For the gentleman who represents the press, since you are more or less neutral on this issue and you didn't address it, what does this new reform actually say that people are finding so objectionable? And for the minister, when do you think the FTA will get through, and when can we look forward to starting to have those protections?
I'm Timothy Towle, a retired Yankee diplomat. Retired is great because that means I can ask my question without clearing it with Hillary Rodham Clinton. My dear friend, former Secretary Otto Reich, who's tough, and really the most important person in this room, if you've not met her, Kelly, who's the Panamanian desk officer of the State Department. You can go try and track down the Secretary of Treasury. He's very busy today with the stock through the roof, and I do. And you can track down Hillary, but she's busy in Benghazi. Talk to Kelly, she does the talking points. This is very important today, what you've done, and it's a fabulous, fabulous thing. The United States has a special relationship with the hemisphere and a very special relationship with Panama, and therefore we should focus on this now and not get distracted with other places where we don't do things as well, Benghazi, Egypt. Afghanistan. You mentioned the drug cooperation, which is so important, as did Ambassador Allen. We're at fault. We're the demand side of this crap. Financial institutions, Guillermo, our financial institutions are money launderers cooperating with people in the neighborhood, of course. And I love to go hunting, but we have weapons that you saw on TV in Benghazi,
Mr.
killing
Ambassador,
people.
Can you
So we're at fault, and we should apologize.
Thank you.
And vigorous politics. I saw politics here. Golly, that's great. You watched TV after the wonderful dinner last night, and you saw our people going at it and their advisors. But we only have a month, and you've got 2014. Poor Panamanian people to go through that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You have a question?
And you're lucky to have an adult. Yeah, right now. You're lucky to have an adult ambassador of the United States in Panama now. Because Jonathan Ferrara, I worked with forever, doesn't raise his voice as I do. He talks quietly and you can hardly hear him. And before he opens his trap, he thinks, and then he carefully talks to the free press and the foreign ministry and the president of the republic. So you're lucky. And the other distinguished ambassador can use her foreign leading activities engaging with a rustic country and system like those neighbors of yours in Nicaragua.
Thank you very much.
My question. Do you agree with me? Does this distinguished panel agree with what I've said?
Okay, good. Great question. Yes, Arturo and back there, we'll try him.
Thank you very much. Congratulations for the amazing presentation. I am Arturo Contreras from the Inter-American Defense College. My question is for Minister de Lima. What is the Panamanian government doing to create the knowledge to support the amazing grew up of the economy of Panama in order to prevent the changes of the future? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah, Michael, here.
Mike Masetic with the PBS Online News Hour. Regarding education, do you have enough teachers there, or are you going to have to bring them in from other places? And in a lot of countries, the various changes, reforms in education have been resisted by teachers and organized teachers groups. Are the teachers in your country with this program, or are they resisting it?
Okay, thank you. Yes, this gentleman here, and then we'll go.
My name is Joe Reeder, and I chaired the Panama Canal Commission from 93 to 97. And I want to applaud Panama first for its anti-trafficking in persons legislation, which they just passed. I've had enormous help from Ambassador Aleman, from Ambassador Jaramillo. It's not just the people trafficking. You all have been promoted now from a very bad category, tier two, what's the last word? Watch, up to tier two. You deserve to be in tier one, but you got to earn it to get there, and you got to follow what's in that statute. Here's my question. I don't think, with all respect to the minister and my dear friend Guillermo Chapman, that you have a bright future unless you top prioritize the fact that your judiciary is rated 133 out of 142 by the International Economic Forum in the world. Now, that rating doesn't belong. And my question to you, sirs, in government, is does Panama have that as a top priority? Because you will not get there. I advise Fortune 100 companies, Sunbeam, who's not going to headquarter there, and they're waiting right now. Lots of other companies aren't going to go there if they don't think they're going to get a fair shake in your courts. So that's question number one. And question number two is, are you going to implement that trafficking statute?
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Yes, right here, a question here. This gentleman here.
Good morning to all the panel. I'm Christopher Toloy. I'm a scholar student from San Jacinto, as well as all my partners right here. I have a quick question for Mr. Chapman and Mr. De Lima. Mr. Chapman addressed in his presentation that the economic model, in order to be sustainable, needs to have a few changes. How would you, which are those changes that need to be, and how are you guys going to implement it in the future years upcoming? I think that Mr. Juan Carlos Varela will be able to answer that question as well. Thanks.
Very much. Luis, right here.
I'm Luis Botello with the International Center for Journalists. I'm really happy to see all these wonderful people, and thank for the organizers and Michael and Jaime and everybody. In terms of the, you know, the media in Panama, as you all know, has always had these contentious relations, as you, Guillermo, has mentioned. But what is it that different now? I mean, the, you know, we have had periods in the history where the media has been, I mean, always under attack. In fact, a lot of the legal cases that are up here at the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, you will see that they have been for years. It has been like a method of intimidating the press to use the legal system. So what is it that is different now, and how is that in terms of for investigative reporting? I know that there have been attempts to do more investigations, but the access to information has been difficult, despite the fact that we have an access to information law. Is it working, and why it is not working in terms to promote transparency? And for the election, in terms of where we are in terms of transparency in campaign finances, I know that, you know, this is extremely important for any democracy to have openness and transparency on campaign finances.
You've been very patient, sir, back there.
Cesar Cañedo, I work at SIFI. SIFI is a financial institution that provides financing to companies working in Latin America. And actually, we are now structuring a couple of deals for company working in Panama. Both companies look very reputable for us based on the experience they have worldwide. And when we were conducting the due diligence in Panama, we saw all the news in the press, and, you know, we haven't found anything strange in the awarding process. They look very reputable companies. And my question to you is, if you were me doing the due diligence, should I consider everything that the press says about the companies, the awarding process, or is it just an internal fight between government and companies? Because we haven't found anything material so far.
Very much. Yes, you've been in the back there, please.
Thank you, Michael. Patrick Kilbride with U.S. Chamber of Commerce. We've been tremendously impressed with the growth trajectory in Panama and think that the FTA will take the bilateral relationship to a new level. But we do share some of the concerns that have been expressed about corruption. And a particular challenge seems to be that transnational criminal organizations could gain a foothold. We've seen an uptick in illicit commerce through the free trade zone, for instance. So I wonder what the government's plans are to address that issue, and is Panama prepared to stake out a leadership role in addressing what really is a global problem? Thanks.
Thank you very much. Yes, back here. Yes.
I'm Courtney Vaughn with Gulf Lady. Thank you so much for your presentation. And if probably Mr. Chapman or the Minister of Economy could shed some light on the stage of development of the financial sector in Panama, and how it has contributed to the maybe last decade investment in growth, and for the future, if there's any reform being done to be able to support it domestically.
Thank you very much. We're going to have just a question here. Phil, you want to ask? Okay. Well, we'll try one right here. Yes, sir.
Jorban Dorsey, Universidad de Panama. For Don Guillermo Chapman, I have a question about the educational system. There is a lack of qualified people in Panama. What, in your opinion, what is the skills that we need to improve on our scholar system? I mean, schools, colleges, universities. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll try Phil McLean here. I'm sorry, we're going to have to.
Hi, I'm Phil McLean, associate here at CSIS. Just a brief question on, you know, in all this wonderful growth and the absolutely shockingly positive economic story, if it's going to be spread around, it's going to be the education system, which is going to do it, the Bolsa Familiar or whatever your name for that. That commonly used scholarship system. But another part is the labor system, and you didn't mention labor reform. When you listed your reforms, labor has been one of them, I believe, just a little bit more development of how the labor system is going to be developed in a way that draws in the totality of the population.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry, there's some other questions, but I think we're going to have to, since we want to end at 11:30, so I'm going to give the panel this opportunity to respond. Obviously, some questions were directed to individuals, but one, Mr. Vice President, you want to start?
Let Mr. De Lima start.
Go ahead.
I think the most important message that you should receive from this is that you have sitting on the same table, people from the different political spectrums, and we're conversing. Last time we went out to dinner, and if we probably meet later, we'll have a drink together. That's the important thing, that Panama, as was mentioned, is a young democracy that's maturing, that people live together peacefully, and what we shouldn't allow is that these political differences that happen in almost all democracies put in risk our economic growth that we're enjoying right now. If I may just address some of the issues that were raised, the free trade agreement. Yes, there are five laws in Congress ready, waiting for approval so the free trade agreement can be come into place by the 1st of October. We're at the 14th of September, so hopefully we can have, you know, after this whole discussion on the electoral reforms are done, we can focus on that. One of the proposals that was included in the Cambio Democrático's electoral reforms was shortening the political electoral period to 6 months, because I agree, I think it's too long. But some opposition political parties are beginning their electoral process in March of next year, almost a year before that, and that's one of the things that was negotiated. We agreed to maintain it at a year. Teachers union, I think that, yes, they are resistant to the changes that have been made, but one of the key attributes that the Minister of Education has is she's a journalist. So she has been able to sway public opinion in her favor, and now you see people, for example, the parents, unions or associations, speaking in favor of what the Ministry of Education is doing, something that didn't occur before, and now you see public opinion in favor of the need of reforming education. The judicial system, people criticize the executive for the shortfalls of the judicial system, but then they criticize the executive for trying to concentrate power. So we're supposed to have a separation of powers. What the executive is doing is increasing the budget allocation to the judicial system, and has done so for the last 3 years. I'm not a lawyer, so I can't go really much into other details of what needs to be fixed, but I agree. I think that as long as we don't have a world-class judicial system, Panama won't be a world, or educational system for that matter, we won't be a first-class country. Campaign finance, in the reforms also, there was to make public the donations. As it works right now, the political parties have to report to the tribunal electorate who their donors are. In 2004, then candidate Martinelli made public his list of donors. I mean, even if the law doesn't ask for it, the candidates are in liberty to make it public if they want to. In regards, we're also in a process of modernizing our money laundering law. It was very effective. It was implemented in 2000. We're in the process of submitting to cabinet a new money laundering law to make it more accord with the times to protect our financial center. We also began the process of negotiating tax treaties with principally OECD countries, and that's why Panama was removed from the OECD gray list, also to protect and strengthen our financial center, which has been a key driver for our economic growth, because due to its, you know, high liquidity, you know, companies in Panama have access to credit lines so they can maintain their growth levels. I think that's roughly
great.
What.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Guillermo?
Yes. First of all, I would agree with Minister de Lima that we need to do a thorough revamping of our judicial system. Just throwing more money at it won't do the trick. The judicial system, to use the kindest word that comes to my mind, is shameful. Nobody could rely on it. How would the TPC work is because it has panels, binational panels, to which U.S. investors, U.S. Entrepreneurs can have access to, and that's the way they will seek redress, which is kind of unfair to Panamanian investors, but that's the way the U.S. government has sought to protect its investors all over the world where it has trade treaties. And the same applies for educational reform. There have been some reforms. Minister Molinar has done a commendable job. But in order to reform education, you have to start by reforming the educators. That's a long-term process. You have to send them back to school. You have to finance them. They are not in no mood to cooperate. You need a revolution there. And that's the second element of changing the model. And you have to introduce a very serious program for training workers. And then you need to go into the political process and provide for the decentralization of political power. The municipal governments in Panama are a joke. They really don't have any power. They don't have any taxing power. They don't have any resources. The basic functions, like building streets, transportation, water supply, sanitation, whatever, that a typical municipal government in any country in the world has, in Panama, they don't do it. So the deputies, the members of parliament, become puppets of the executive in order to raise monies to provide those services. And the executive provides the money through so-called items, budget items that go through the legislators, to the deputies, the congressmen, to the different districts. And in order to have legislators who really work on national issues, on national legislation, you have to make sure that the municipal governments have the resources and the capacity to solve local problems, and not the legislators elected by the different circumscriptions.
Guillermo, we'll have to try to wrap up the any other questions. Yeah.
And then labor. We need labor reform, and somebody mentioned here, and more flexible migration laws. Ours are as bad as yours. And the agricultural thing. The financial center is very open internationally, and it provides for adjustment when it buys, it accumulates external assets. It deposits the assets international. When it needs to finance the local economy, it brings in external assets and provides financing to the economy. It has been a very good source of financing. And then with respect to the money laundering, the question is try to open an account in Panama. It's more difficult than opening a bank account in the United States.
Thank you very much. Guillermo, do you want to address the question on the press?
Yes, but just let me put something clear. Somebody here says, here we are, different political groups. I don't belong to any political group. I'm an independent, just to make it clear, okay? And the other thing is, the question about transparency is the top secret in our country that nobody wants to let know to our people who puts the money in the winner or in the second or in the third people who's running for any post. Now, is it true that in these times there are narco politics and there's a lot of money that in other countries has been denounced that are part of the political system? So what we need in Panama, we'd like to know, I'm sure that you will agree with me to know, why not say this guy and this guy, they give me support. So that's part of the question. The transparency is part of the problem we have with every government. It's not only this government. This is a matter of a cultural situation. Nobody wants to change. We have a bipartisan reality in Panama, and then as Mr. Nadima says, suddenly appears a third party. It's true, but that was a signal that our population sends. We are tired of the same politics. Now, if that signal is not counted as part of a reality, maybe in the next election, there's going to be a surprise, because it's evident that the system is tired, is part of many years in that change, like in a lot of countries in America. Now, to finally, what we are looking for in Panama is that the officials in every government, they try to put a shield on them, that nobody can disagree with them. To disagree today more than yesterday, because this is not the first president. We have been, there was a president called Toro Pérez Valladares. Toro is bull. Mm-hmm. He was a bully. Yeah, bully. So it's not the first. Mr. Martinelli, don't trust me. Just read the newspapers, look for TV stations, read the station. That's the truth. What I said here, is part of a continuous situation. Yesterday, let me say, give you a good news or a bad news. Two journalists were condemned for $20,000, because they make a cover of a road close to a high rank officer. He was a part of a Supreme Court, or he was a minister, and the Ministry of Public Works built this road in front of his house to benefit this guy. And you know what happened? That's the end of the story. Yesterday they have to pay $20,000 because he feels that, what are they doing in my private life? No. An official is an official 24 hours a day. And they forget sometimes that they are public personalities, and they cannot divorce one thing from the other. So that's part of the situation. There is another menace of $1 million in a suit that are building now. So I repeat, my intervention here was the the sum of different events that are all in the media are here in the States, in the human rights are here in many places. So you can choose if you want to see what's happening. But just read the newspapers or listen to TV or radio.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank you and Stephen for organizing this. I think it's very important for the world, especially the United States, to see what is happening in Panama. As I said, in 1977, the Canal Treaty was signed by Carter and Torrijos, the Torrijos-Carter Treaty for Panama. And one of the assumptions there that was a legitimate recognition of the right to self-determination through democracy for Panama. And we tried to start a democracy process back then that we have started in 1990 after Just Cause. And this process, it's in jeopardy right now. And that is very important to know and to realize. Since 1990, we have had several elections. All of them have been won by the opposition. And we have had several referendums. All of them have been won by the opposition. Why is that? I don't know. But that is a fact. The only referendum that was a national referendum and had no opposition was the referendum on the canal. So we need to realize what is going on in Panama with the rule of law. The reform commission established by the electoral court has been proposing changes to better the electoral law since 1990. Four experiences have been a success. This time, with this government, the experience failed. We had plenty of good reforms, transparency. We set limits to what you can spend. We set limits to a single donor. And we requested to publish in the web the report that candidates can fabricate to the electoral court because we cannot use them. We just have to have them there. Thanks to the report that they have to file and that we can use, we did use them in one case, and we show that official monies were used in a political campaign last year. Panama is a showcase for Latin America. We are an experience, and we are a good and positive experience. There's no need to go through a turmoil to strengthen our institutions. Right now, we, the Panamanian people, the majority of the people, has a perception. And as we speak, there are, the government party is trying to approve a reform to the electoral law, custom designed by the ruling party, disregarding the consensus and the reform of the national reform, Electoral Reform Commission. We are going through a very difficult electoral process. We will go through if we don't change our attitude. And only awareness will change that attitude. The Electoral Court is the referee. We are neutral. But if one of the players start committing faults, we have to call on them, and they don't like it. And if they discredit the referee, if they discredit the process, there's a chance that the people will doubt the legitimacy of the elections in 2 years. We have to guarantee a fair play in a level field.
Thank you very much. Mr. Vice President, you have the last word.
Thank you, Michael. Well, first of all, as you see,
we disagree in some points with Minister de Lima, but we all the speakers, we agree in one thing. We all see a bright future for our country, even though all the different issues that were debated here. About negative campaign, I agree with Minister de Lima that in the U.S. you see a lot of negative campaign. But I disagree with him because President Obama doesn't paint his negative campaign with the commission coming from the government agency that spent a lot of money in the government image. That's totally different. When for every five commercials that the government runs, since the agency that runs all the government propaganda also runs the government campaign, then the commission, which is 20%, will go on negative campaign against the vice president and other political candidates. So that's not fair play, but that's part of politics. Also, I agree that we are a very small country and we all know each other. So even though that I can have difference with Minister de Lima, that when they try to sell assets for close to $3 billion, land of the Colon Free Zone, the Church of the Electrical Companies, the Church of Kellogg and Wireless, then I had to invite political leaders of other opposition party, which has been in conflict with us for the past 40 years. Even that party stole from my party two elections, 1968 and 1989, and I invite them to my party to put together a Front for Democracy to stop that, and we stop it, and we're here. We stop that, and we stop the president for appointing three new Supreme Court judges that will give him a strong majority in the Supreme Court to be able to change electoral laws, maybe intern re-election, maybe try to change different things. As I speak to you, I'm here in Washington. Probably Panamanians are going to Congress now to try to stop this electoral reform, which is not good for the country. But at the end of the country, we move forward. We have enough teachers. We have to train our teachers. We have to protect our logistic system from being used by organized crime. I think we're doing that. We have to change our different things in our education system because our economy is creating new jobs, but the education system needs to create people that can take those jobs. If not, then we have to open, as it happened in pilots and other architects, civil engineers, and other professions, people have to come from other countries to help us because the economy is creating a lot of new technical jobs and we need to train our people for that. There's a lot of challenge for our country, but I feel optimistic about it. The only thing is that since radar were invented, pilots avoid storms and they get you to the airport without going through a storm because you can avoid the storms. You just go above, go below, take a different alternative route. But it seems that our pilot like this going through a storm. But even though he likes that, the plane, believe me, I can be honest to you, we're going to a very tense election, but the plane is going to get to the airport and Panamanians will leave happy and will be a great country for everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.